8-8.
Ladies and gentlemen, good morning and welcome to this State of the Union panel on the transitions, disorders and women in the Middle East. We are very happy to have you here today and to have hopefully an interesting panel discussion on a number of concerning issues about in the region. We have here today Heba Raoufezat from Egypt. She's a political scientist, a lecturer at the Cairo University, recently in LSE London. Olivier Roy, to my right, to my left, as a well-known chair of Robert Schuman and SPS in the EUI, and doesn't need to be presented. And Nadia Marzucchi, research fellow at the Robert Schuman Center of Advanced Studies, as well as a CNRS researcher in Paris. I'm myself the chair, Luigi Narbone. I'm the director of the new Middle East Directions program of the Robert Schuman Center. This is a new program we are trying to develop to focus mainly on concerning issues in the region. We have trying to develop a research program based on field work and empirical research on ongoing transformations at the political, social, economic, and religious level in the region, but also looking at the state of disorder that characterizes the region and with the political, geopolitical implications and the various conflicts that are modifying the geographical map of the region and some of the flows that have been changing also the way the region functions in socio-economic terms. Today, with the panel, we are going to try to look at the specific dimension of the ongoing transformations 5 years after the Arab Springs. The state of collapse, which have unfortunately characterized some of the countries, the Syria, Iraq, Libya, civil wars, and the impact on neighboring countries, but also what this means for the societies and for women in particular, which is the theme of this State of the Union in the region. I think I would, without further ado, pass the floor to Dr. Eba. She will tell us about her vision of how the transition is affecting social groups and how the state of disorder and conflict is being used. And I think she will have also a critical vision of what the EU has been doing in the region, and will certainly be a good base of for discussion later on. Dr. Ebert.
Assalamu alaikum, everybody. Peace for you and good morning. Good sunny spring morning and peaceful. Though we are going to talk about a region that is not enjoying peace very much. Before discussing the situation and putting the map in front of you, I would like to talk a bit about my own, where I come from, why I am interested in this. I used to write about gender and women, and some of those who know my academic work know that, but I actually stopped doing this for some time now, because I thought that in many situations in the Arab and the Muslim world, and especially now with the migrants' problems in the EU, as well with the different communities that have been displaced and moving to the European society, regardless of how the policymakers look at things, but the dynamics on the ground and the cultural and social questions that they pose indicated for long that it's not only about women, it's about the wider map. How to situate women's issues on the changing maps of order and disorder, if we can say so. And that's why actually the essence of my talk will be about naming and framing. So how we name specific phenomena, how we label them, and framing, within which frame do we put them, to be able actually to understand what's going on and hence take policy directions. I'm not a policy person, so this is the problem of the policymakers. But my issue and my concern as a human being, not only as an academic and researcher, is basically to understand the world, to give meaning to the world in a moment where giving meaning to the world has become more and more difficult, especially for the younger generations. Imagine yourself being displaced and then subject to human trafficking and then moving to a new country and then getting a new citizenship and then having to look for a job and sustain your children or yourself. You have to give people meaning. People address us as social scientists and say, I mean, what is this about? Let alone address us as people of faith and say, what's the wisdom of God of all that? You know, war, why? What is the logic of evil? What is the philosophy of evil, the rationale of evil in the world? And hence, there are so many questions that are rising, and some of them are essentially ethical, actually, and this is where the EU has to put some effort. You know, what is the ethic, what are the ethics of the EU regarding addressing the region? So naming and framing is what is at stake. What we used to do for long is basically place women's issues when we are dealing with the Middle East in terms of social change and democratic transition. For about three decades, or maybe even four decades now, we have been talking about women's empowerment and women and gender issues in the Middle East, taking it from the societal to the political, and also to the economic, how to empower women. Research has been done about the single women sustaining their families, impoverishment, and how to provide women with a decent quality of life, women and children issues, etc. But actually the problem where I come from political theory, was also that the theory itself within which the issues of women were framed has been changing and facing problems. We have been increasingly being less able to explain what is going on. Since the Iranian Revolution, if we want to go back for the older generation in the room, you know, when everybody was struck by the Iranian Revolution, and how come that mullahs with turbans on their head can lead a revolution, let alone win vis-a-vis a regime like the Shah regime. It was not a problem of politics, it was a problem of paradigm, that nobody expected religion to come back, because we were told in the 60s that religion should fade away. And hence, the mullahs were there, Khomeini was in Paris, he was acting very strongly on the ground, people were mobilizing, but it was not on the screen, because the screen could not see the phenomena because it was not in the system. The system said this should not happen. Revolution and religion have nothing to do with each other, except when it comes to the situation in Latin America where you have a liberation theology. This can work, but Islam, revolution, it wouldn't work, especially with 80 years old mullahs, you know. What happened then later to the Iranian revolution is a different story, how it went to become really something completely different and far away from revolution. But at the end of the day, how do we see, how do we name and frame, and how do we understand? So quite early in the 90s, some of the scholars in the Middle East have confirmed to us, the younger generation at the time of political scientists, that the state as an apparatus, the modern territorial state, will stay with us for some time. They said, yes, it has been rooted by force by colonialism, for those who enjoy the leftist discourse, okay? And it has been forced upon us. But at the end of the day, since the 50s and 60s, it has been functioning. You know, the alternative is either chaos, going back to the old primordial social structures, or the fear of an Islamic state. So let's just stick to the territorial nation state. It has got its own problems, but it's, the machine is functioning like an old car. Fix it here and there. You can't afford to buy yourself a new one, and there is no problem. There is no potential that we can actually shift to something else that is clear for people. So, but now here comes 2011, 2010, 2011, and the state started facing serious problems. Before that, already Iraq has been facing a problem as a state, so it has been pioneering in this direction towards the collapse and the decay of a state, and then Syria joined, and then Yemen joined, Libya, and then the situation is becoming more and more turbulent in the Arab world. So how can we then place women's issues within this dilemma and with this within this disorder that we are seeing? In the 80s, there has been a project led by the Center for the Study of Arab Unity, which is a very famous research center in Beirut in Lebanon, for those who know the literature in Arabic. And it has spotted that the region is actually facing dilemma on four different, in four different domains. The different dialectics or problems of unity and disintegration. It spotted it right from that time. The dialectic between the domestic and the regional and international. You cannot understand one specific country and case unless you have a wider look. Why not only do these systems collapse, but also why others manage to survive, like Tunisia, for example. Is it the size? Which is very important, by the way, in politics. Size matters in politics. You can sort of maintain order in small units, but when you go, you grow big, you know, it's harder to maintain order and unity. And then the dialectic between the big narratives and the small narratives, the cultural issues, you know, this is the Arab world, this is the Middle East. How do you call it in the first place? Do you bring in Iran and Turkey into the analysis? There are similarities, or is it just the Arab world, the MENA region, North Africa? What is it? What are we talking about? And what is the rationale of the culture and of the mind of the people in this place? And also the dialectic between the material and the spiritual. So the role of religion in the region, and under each and every title of that, you can put the issues of women. So when you are talking about unity and disunity or disorder, you are talking about on what basis is disorder founded, and then you can talk about linguistic problems, ethnic problems, and then you walk from Morocco to Kurdistan, and you find that women are partly Arab, but partly also Arab-speaking, but partly belonging to an ethnic group. And ethnicity is important because it is a source of solidarity, but it can also turn into a capsule where women actually are labeled as part of their own groups. And it's the same problem with multiculturalism. It's great because it gives people the ability to express their own visions in life and worldviews, but at the same time, it can be an umbrella for injustice for women who are just labeled as such and that culture, while they want to be treated apart from their culture, maybe as independent citizens or take the cultural dimension, but individually they decide how it is fixed, not in the laws, for example, where they cannot maneuver if they are labeled, etc. Women also between the domestic and the regional and international, the whole relation between the women's movement and gender perspective that developed in the West and the expressions and manifestations in the Middle East and in the South generally, and the whole talk about Islamic feminism and how we can actually deal with the a standardization of women's issues in a way, even if the voices differ and the languages differ, but at the end of the day, there is a dominant paradigm that actually excludes and includes in a way. I'm not an Islamic feminist, by the way. And the big narratives and the small narratives and the spiritual and the material or the worldly. And here also, when we talk about the material and the orderly, there has been a lot of studies, there have been a lot of policies, there have been a lot of programs relating to women and Islam. While actually, interestingly enough, we are witnessing now in the region a rise of orthodoxy, especially in Egypt and the eastern part of the Arab world. There is an obvious rise of orthodoxy, and there is a rise of orthodoxy, of Christian orthodoxy, globally. And for those who follow the Coptic Orthodox Church in Egypt and the role that it plays in politics now that it has been rising, but also in Russia. So don't take the support of the Orthodox Church of Putin lightly. Don't take the visit of the Orthodox Pope to the Catholic Pope lightly. Some things look like as if they are trying to bring Christendom together, you know, the different churches and bridge the historical gaps, etc. But the political is very clear. And how this will have impact on women in the region who belong to Christian faith. So, and generally, how it would affect their weight in the society. I think that if we look at Egypt, for example, I wrote a text about maybe 10 years ago, during the time of Mubarak, saying that when we look at women's situation, especially on the political level in the Arab world, we should be very careful, back to naming and framing. So we celebrate the number of women present in the parliament, but we don't ask ourselves what parliaments these are. Were they actually democratically elected, or they were elected under the umbrella of authoritarian regimes? And I, at the time, I described the concern or the problematic at the moment, at that time, with feminization of authoritarianism. That sometimes in some regimes, and this was actually very present in Iraq during the time of Saddam, that women are presented in the front and on the stage as if women's presence in the system and representation, the women that the regime accepts, is a sign of democratization. And I think that this is a fake indicator. In Egypt, after 2013, people are divided. Some people call it a coup. Some people call it the second wave of the uprisings and revolution, because people went to the streets to call for the outset of the elected president and actually celebrated that the army interfered. You should ask who did that and the percentage, etc. But it's a different story. So let's just call it the change that took place at the hand of the army in Egypt 2013. Followed that, we had a constitution. Following that, we had a parliament. The parliament of 2012, under the Muslim Brothers, had only 11 women. The parliament in Egypt today has 78 women. So I don't think that society became so democratic in 2 years to shift the acceptance of women representation to that degree. So here you have a parliament with a substantial presence of women, the percentage not only doubled but tripled and, you know, multiplied. But how far can you take this as an indicator if you want to just, you know, do some listing of the changes or achievements or statistical analysis of what's going on? Naming and framing again, how do you see things going on? Yesterday, if this is just an example, if we stick to Egypt also, since the change in 2013 with the intervention of the army, almost 3,000 women have been subject either to forceful detention or a forceful disappearance. 3,000 women. At the moment, there are about 90 young women in prison. Some of them, when they entered prison, they were still children according to the international standard. They were below 18. So these women do not appear on the screen when the 78 women in the parliament appear on the screens. You know, so you have to understand which indicators do you take for the wider situation of women and the degree of securitization or securing women. Securitizations of issues of women is different from securing women, actually. So, and what is going on the street, this is also very important. If we move to Syria, yesterday, the Arab Women Organization, which is affiliated with the Arab League, launched a report about the situation of refugee women, focusing mainly on mentioning women from Iraqi background, because refugee women since the crisis, the prolonged crisis in Iraq has been going on, also suffered from forceful eviction and displacement, etc. But it focused mainly on the Syrian women. And the figure, that estimated figure of displaced Syrians from Syria who had to leave the country is about 4 million plus. Almost half of them are in Turkey. A substantial number are in Lebanon. That actually makes now in Lebanon almost a quarter of the population, which is a huge number. You're not taking migrants, you are taking like a new small population within your own nation. And of course in Jordan, less in Egypt, a very trivial number compared to these figures. And the report it's about 140 pages report. It talks about the agony of women and how they have been suffering in terms of security, in terms of the conditions through which they went in order to leave their own country, where they were eventually settled, the conditions for themselves and for their children, safety, security, education, health, the small details. And I know that I don't have time to talk a lot about the situation of refugee women or migrant women due to conflict and crisis in the region, but I think that if we are talking about policies usually are a sort of big narratives. You know, they talk about big figures and they talk about what they see as essential. Well, I think that according to the report, if we read it carefully, the suffering of women whom the report quotes are small in details. Like, for example, in some countries, in order for you to register as a migrant, you have to go and do some official papers. No matter how little you have to pay for a stamp, for an official, a procedure, you pay a penny here, a penny there, they don't have the penny. So some women are not registered and they don't enjoy benefits simply because they don't have these small amounts of money. Or the children cannot have proper education because the system legally does not allow that, and hence you have to change the legal process in order to give them the right to join public schools, for example, which was actually the problem that was faced by refugees in Egypt that I saw personally who came from southern Sudan. They used to be taught informally in churches in Egypt, Muslims and Christians, by the way, churches played a very important role in educating them because they could not join the public schools because of some legal, administrative, procedural issues. So you have, when you think about policy, not only think about the macro, but also think about the micro, how to allocate funds for small things that actually make people's lives easier, and go to the people and ask them, what actually do you need? Disorder spreads. So don't expect that if there is disorder, are you hearing me? So, okay, yeah. I used to hear my voice, so I relate to my voice. Disorder spreads, so don't expect that if things go wrong somewhere else, you are safe, basically. And I think this is the lesson of what happened in Syria. And the Turkish-European deal was not the most fair one, but it was under conditions of necessity. So it's just, let's learn the lessons of the situation, of how then to think about women's issues. I have been addressed by different journalists in the Western world, in Europe, asking me, how should we deal with men who have come to our societies because of the masculine culture and the misogynist culture of the Arab and Muslim world? Well, actually, I wanted them to ask me about how to treat women, because we also have a culture about how to treat women, especially women who have been under such situations that humiliated their essential dignity. There are lists of topics that I can talk about, but I think that, generally speaking, it is very important to highlight the fact that in times of disorder, the whole agenda of women's issues changes. Changes to the very basic, changes to survival, changes to essential and basic quality of life provisions, changes to family concerns, little children, and if you watch the different documentaries about women carrying their children on their back and walking across Europe, basically, then you have to ask yourself, what should we do about that? It's not about organizing a program here, talking about women and taking care of them, health issues, education. It's also about sort of a new paradigm shift in how to think about women, and also to forget the gap between the East and West, because when it comes to the essential basic needs of humanity, we are not talking about culture, we're talking about civility. We're talking about the essence of civility. And I think that the EU has to think in terms of essence of civility and in terms of humanism.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And in terms of humanism, rather than in terms of what culture do those people come from, how are we going to deal with them, and the concern about the migrants in terms of the homogeneity of societies that they immigrate to. Disorder needs a lot of effort to go back to order, but order does not necessarily mean that you have to go back to the past. There are so many changes that took place, and women participated in uprisings and in times of crisis in the Arab world. And I think that a new paradigm is needed, and a new shift in understanding of the maps of women's needs in the region is very much needed. Four months ago, I was hosted by Donatella Della Porta in the Scuola Superiore. I don't know the, yeah. So, and my talk was about what Arab uprisings actually exposed about Western democracy. Western democracy has got its own limitations. Every model has got its own limitations. Modernity has got its own limitations. And I think that there are new topics, for example, that are rising now, and I was talking this morning earlier with Luigi about the return of tribalism, for example. How do we think about women's situations in societies in the Arab world that are basically, the conditions are basically tribal? When the state collapses, people go back to their primordial identities. So there is a rise of the tribe. How do we deal with that? Is it something in our sciences that we learned the tribe is something negative, the tribe is something backward, the tribe is pre-modern? But actually, this was the refuge. In the countries where tribes were strong, women survived better. In the countries that were more modernized, where there were no tribes in some areas, women actually were devastated because they couldn't turn, societies could not pull themselves together. So again, should we continue to think with a modern mind, or should we go beyond modernity to think more in different, more innovative ways, a bit critical of modernity, a bit critical of the nation-state paradigm, but also more compassionate rather than practical or pragmatic or fully into the details of logistics and programs and minor allocations of funds, etc. There is a need of a paradigm. There is a need of what does Europe want to do and what role it wants to play, not in the Arab world, but in the world generally. I mean, I also was talking to Luigi in the morning, asking him, what did the European Union do in terms of what happened in Ukraine, for example? So there was there were higher expectations, but the outcome was very minimal. and the crisis is still going on in a great degree. And there are similarities. I sat with people from Ukraine, and they said that in some situations they applied the same strategies that people applied in the uprisings in the Middle East to secure neighborhoods and to provide when the state could not provide, or when the system could not provide for them in times of crisis, for example. So how then to actually, if you want to train people, instead of training them on a specific model of stability that is based on stability, even in times of displacement, but the paradigm is based on assumptions of stability, we have to think not in terms of disorder, but in terms of different orders. And I will finish here because I was told only 2 minutes left. It's amazing through the past 5 years that for social scientists who have been looking at the maps, that under the political disorder, there is an anthropological order. And this is what should take our attention. How to think about societies in times of disorder as anchors for order. And how in times of peace, civility should be fostered. I wrote with my mentor at LSE, maybe a few years ago, a text about civility and violence, Mary Kaldor. And at the time, I reflected about a notion of preemptive civility. In times of crisis, you have to have a capital of civility, not only locally, but also globally, to draw on. But if we don't have that credit of civility, we will run out of civility in times of crisis. And it is embedded in culture, in learning, in education, in public sphere liberties, in religious discourse that fosters civility and tolerance and freedom of human agency. And I think these are the roots of civility. And these are the seeds that we should seek to throw in the soil of what we see as disorder, but what also contains a lot of factors of social order that only disappear when human life disappears. And this is also one of the challenges, because we are witnessing disappearance of human life by war. And the notion of war here is very important. Aleppo has been facing destruction, like many other cities in Syria, in an unprecedented way. There is an herbicide, not only a genocide, but an herbicide. This we witnessed in Iraq before, and we are witnessing it now in Syria. And when this happens, herbicide and genocide and war crimes, then women are just like men, like children, like anybody else. You're talking about civility and society rather than civil society in the associational meaning. And here we have to reflect. We can't actually reflect alone. We have to reflect together. We have to. I stopped for a while giving big public lectures, and I opted now for small groups of thinking, because I think we have to talk more to each other about our notions of civility that I have been trying to focus on for a long time. In my society, people, when they talk about secularism, they talk about the civil state, meaning the civil state in terms of political state. Well, actually, the origin of the world in political thought, because I'm a political thought instructor, professor, lecturer, whatever, is l'état civil. L'état civil is not the state. It is the state of civility. It's not the civil state vis-à-vis the religious state or vis-à-vis the military state. It's l'état civil de société. It's the civil state of the society. It's civility. And I think that this is what we should shift to save civility in times of disorder, but also to see how people, and to learn how people in different situations actually manage to maneuver based on their own social and civil ethics, rather than the presence of a civil society that actually is not present in many situations when there is crisis and war. I had many other points, but I should stop here.
Thank you, Eba, for this very interesting and suggestive overview of how the disorder in the region is affecting the role of women And also, the look you're giving, the critical look you give to how they reconstitute an order out of the state of disorder, and that certainly is an element we could discuss further. But I would pass now the floor to Nadia Marzouki to look at the case of Tunisia more specifically, and perhaps give us some suggestions about also the question of the role of women.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Luigi, for including me in this panel. Heba, it was very inspiring to listen to your talk. Thank you. And I will follow up on something you said. Order doesn't mean you have to go back to the past. And unfortunately, even though Tunisia has been praised as the democratic miracle of the Arab Spring, whenever I go back to Tunis, what I hear is, well, it was maybe better under Ben Ali. So we are in that time now where you hear that kind of regret for the past, and we are definitely, even in Tunisia, in a what we could call a counter-revolutionary phase. And I want to say a few words about this. Just to begin with, maybe put this arrival of the counter-revolution into context, it wasn't a big surprise. I want to quote from a great article published by Robert Malley and Hussein Aga in the New York Review of Books in February 2011, when they were very clairvoyant and wrote, "February 11 was the culmination of the Arab Revolution. On February 12, the counter-revolution began." And I think by this provocation, what they mean is that, in a way, the fact that the counter-revolution began in 2013, and according to them, even before, is not a big surprise. In a way, it's an effect of the characteristics, of the originality of the revolutions that took place in Egypt and in Tunisia. These revolutions were, as you all know, horizontal, with no leader, no clear program, and so they were very important, but they didn't manage to fundamentally change the structures of power. The structures of power, and they were not able to challenge the structures of deep state and the locus of corruption of power in Egypt, but also in Tunisia. Also, I think it could be said that in a way these revolutions were without revolutionaries. Of course, there were people in the streets in Tahrir, in Kasbah, but then the parties, thanks to which the revolutions translated into some kind of political transition, namely the Islamist party Nahda in Tunisia and the Muslim Brothers in Egypt, were not revolutionaries. I want to be very clear here. I'm not talking about the questions, are they Democrat, are they not? I actually refer here to this great article by Tariq Massoud. I think it doesn't matter really what they are sincerely, but they were not revolutionaries. As far as Egypt is concerned, I think this article by Asef Bayat, "Revolution Without Movement, Movement Without Revolution," really sums up how it is that Islamists in Egypt were in a way too well integrated already in the Mubarak regime, so that in a way they had no interest in really upsetting completely the structures of the system. By contrast, Assad argues, Islamists in Iran in 1979 had a different incentive in being really revolutionaries. Similarly, even though there are differences, Islamists in Tunisia were not revolutionaries. They turned out to be Democrats, but they were not revolutionaries because their primary goal was to be included in the political system, which is a laudable objective, but the fact is that they had no interest in upsetting the structures of the deep state and in challenging it. And the present coalition, the present very odd coalition with the former enemy, the party of the former regime, Nida Tunis, is a perfect embodiment of this strategy. So I want to say a few words about the counter-revolution in Tunisia, and I may surprise you, as I know a lot of people, especially in Europe, are really keen on the fairy tale, the Tunisian fairy tale, the Tunisian democratic fairy tale. Tunisia is the country that succeeded. They got the Nobel Prize, and they are very happily on the road to democracy. I would like to believe in this story, but I think it's important also to follow up on what you said, Heba, to emphasize the role of framing and naming and qualify this story. So, of course, compared to Egypt, the counter-revolution is not as harsh and as depressing yet as in Egypt. However, it takes more subtle form, namely two forms, commodification and denial. So I will explain briefly these two points. By commodification, I mean the sort of neutralization of the concept of Thawra by what I call the NGOization of society. So Thawra became a cool, inefficient, neutralized reference in the work of a lot of NGOs, a lot of artist associations, a lot of human rights associations who refer to this vague notion of 2011, but without really turning it into a political project to really counter the return of the former regime and to counter, to challenge corruption, to challenge the structures of the deep state. When I talk of the commodification of Thawra, I also want to refer to the reality of the fragmentation of struggles. So you were talking about civil society and civility, and I think this is a very, very important concept to think about this this notion that the, in particular, the EU loves, which is civil society. And civil society is deeply corrupted. It's not just the state that is corrupt, but civil society is deeply fragmented, deeply corrupted. So there is a difference between a plural civil society and a fragmented, corrupt civil society that is, in a way, neutralized by the reality of how it has to apply to different sources of funding in order to exist and to promote very fragmented agendas. The second form of the counter-revolution is a revisionist rewriting of the revolution, a reintegration of the break that 2011 represents, and into the supposedly long continuous history of reformism, of Tunisian reformism. So what official leaders from the two ruling parties now are doing jointly is reintegrating the Thawra into this long history of reform, bringing back 2011 into the continuity of the fundamental pact of 1861 in Tunisia, of the various episodes of the colonial and post-colonial history, bringing continuity instead of admitting that 2011 clearly represents an important rupture and a break and should be respected and addressed as such. So this restorationist approach to the recent history and this sort of subtle approach to the counter-revolution did translate into policy and effect. It's not just at the level of discourse. It did translate in the past summer into the bill, the National Reconciliation Bill, that was proposed by the government and that was aimed at basically granting pardon without judgment to businessmen who used to be involved in a lot of corruption under the Ben Ali rule. it translates into the sort of paralysis and sclerosis of the political field presently that is due to this odd coalition between the two former adversaries. And here I also want to go back to this present coalition is lauded in the name of stability, but again, as Heba said, to what extent does order and stability justify a sort of return to the past order, and to what extent should we, on the contrary, push to understand the need for creating a different order instead of always going back to this sort of blackmail? You know, it's better to have this, to postpone conflict and to postpone democracy because now there's the war on terror. So I'm really concerned about the implications of this type of framework. And what we see now also, which is also worrying, is in the discourse of intellectuals, of Tunisian intellectuals, a new infatuation with the military. So as you know, the military is an institution that traditionally has had a very little role in Tunisian politics, and probably it's one of the factors that explained the positive outcome of the transition so far. But in the context of the multiple terrorist attacks, you now see the development of this pro-military discourse within a certain milieu of very secularist intellectuals that is also quite worrying and feeding into this whole counter-revolutionary narrative. And finally, and this will be my last point, you see under the Nahda Nida government policy of moral order, criminalization of the youth, criminalization of social movements, securitization of the youth, again in the name of stability, in the name of postponing conflict and the need for national unity. Again, I mean, Heba, your talk was really inspiring, because I think if you want to bring back the question of women's rights and gender equality more broadly, it's interesting to see how supposedly this modernist party that Nida Tunis claims to embody during the campaign of 2014 ends up actually promoting a policy towards the youth, towards women that is extremely conservative, based on the securitization, based on criminalization of every form of artistic expression, that is way more conservative than anything Nahda did when they were in power. So here it's also interesting to qualify the very frequent association of secularism, Nida Tunis, and state feminism. What we see, on the contrary, is that women's rights are not really progressing under the so-called under the guidance of this so-called secularist party comes down mostly to representing the interests and the discourse of the former regime. So I will end here, but I really just want to say that, of course, the counter-revolution in Tunisia is not as strong as in Egypt, but I think it's important to seriously qualify the success story, the narrative of the democratic miracle in Tunisia, and to take into account the fact that the forces of resistance, the forces that are advocating for a continuation of the democratic process, of the pluralization of civil society, these forces are real, they are not completely crushed, but they are highly fragmented, and they are operating again in a civil society that is highly corrupt and maybe in a way sick because of the legacy of the years of dictatorship. So on that note, I think I will end with a sort of bittersweet evaluation of the present situation in Tunisia. I would love to tell you a better story, but this is my assessment. Thank you.
Thank you, Nadia. It's also seems to be a point that returns the question of how, in the new counter-revolutionary mode that affects Tunisia, but also many other countries in the region, the dichotomy of stability versus disorder is appears to be the key. It certainly doesn't help in promoting the need for a new creativity in designing the new order in the region. Certainly doesn't help in promoting the cause of democracy, and moreover doesn't help in promoting gender equality behind the fake perhaps sometimes images that are trying to be projected. We are still facing a very sad story. So I would ask now Olivier Roy to perhaps comment on what has been discussed, and Olivier.
Thank you very much. I will start from where Reba started, and I will finish on where Nadia finished. So it's a good sum up. Yeah. Yes, at the beginning of the so-called, you know, Islamic revolution, Islamic movement, and what you want, the idea was, and still has been for years, that on the one hand, we have secularism with progressive modern values, including feminism, democracy, and so, and on the other hand, Islamism with conservative religious values. And of course, there was a counter-narrative from the Islamists saying we are not conservative, we are not reactionary. We think that there is an Islamic concept of dignity, of social justice, of feminism, and so on and so. And for years, you know, we were debating on that. But something is new since recently. What we have is, I would say, the secularization of moral order. The fact that the conservative values are no more associated with the secularist versus Islamic narrative. There is something which is interesting, which has been mentioned by Nadia, is that we have a conservative backlash everywhere now, even in countries where the Arab Spring is supposed to have won, Tunisia. If you take, I'm speaking about the countries on war, you know, that's another story. But if you take countries where, like Egypt, Tunisia, Morocco, and to a certain extent Algeria, we have recently saw a wave of trials, suits, opinion campaign, you know, against precisely homosexuality, sexual freedom, apostasy, blasphemy, and so on and so. We have homosexuals are now prosecuted in Egypt and in Morocco to an extent which has never been the case before. As Nadia said, you know, during the short leadership of the Muslim Brothers, you had no process, no trials on homosexuality, blasphemy, and so. Probably for political reasons, you know. I'm not saying that these guys were liberals, you know. But of course they knew that any kind, you know, of process, trial against homosexual activities would have a huge impact in Western public opinion, and everybody would say, look, these Islamists, they are killing the gays, and so on and so. But now that it's under Sisi, or even in Tunisia and in Morocco, you know, and the so-called progressive, secular, modern regimes, silence, you know, silence. And so we just question, you know, what does it mean, this conservative backlash? Is it just, you know, part of political counter-revolution, a way of controlling the society? And in Egypt, we may say it looks like that, you know. It's quite normal that an authoritarian regime is authoritarianist at every level, including at the level of moral order. But you cannot say that about Tunisia, you know. So I think there is something more than just moral order as a way of political and social control. There is more than that. And as Reba said, I think that we have here an anthropological issue. That we have some sort of, artificial reconstruction of the good society, you know, where everybody is at his or her due place. You know. And family, no gender issue, you know, the traditional sexual divide, good family, good mores, good morals. You know, and our society is a society where there is no homosexuality. Homosexuality is either Western and Zionist importation, as everybody knows, you know, that prostitution, of course, is a consequence of Westernization, tourism, and what you want. There is a big debate in Morocco now on this movie, which it's a Moroccan movie, you know, it's not a Western movie. But the principal actress cannot go back to Morocco. She has been threatened, and she has been left without any protection. To be threatened is quite usual, you know. But to be attacked by the press and with the government looking the other way, it's a sign that it's not just, you know, part of the public opinion which is upset. So what we have now is a kind of reaffirmation of a secularization of traditional society, you know, reaffirmation of culture, our culture, both against Islam in a sense, you know, because Islam is brought by the courts, and so not as an orthodoxy, not as a theology, but as a custom, as a tradition. And in this case, you cannot discuss tradition. You can discuss Sharia principle, you know, by looking back to the Sharia. But if the judge says, it's our tradition, so what do? You know, you say, no, I don't want this tradition, and so you are a traitor. No. You are working for the Western culture and so. And it's, what is, and I will end on that because I think that the floor has a lot of questions. The interesting fact is that there is a mirror effect, you know, with how the West is framing now the Arab world, more than the Muslim world, the Cologne story, you know, Cologne story in December 31st. The idea was, look, this guy is the expression of their culture. No. Not so much of their religion. When there is a mention to Islam, it's Islam as a culture. No. So we have this mirror effect of trying to identify, you know, Islam with a traditional culture. So to close the door of theological and philosophical thinking and reflection about what Islam is, and to resuscitate a traditional society which doesn't exist, you know. It's very clear that in the Maghreb, which I know better than other places, of course, the traditional family is dead, you know. The traditional forms of solidarity is dead, because in most of the Maghreb's cities, you don't have what Eba mentioned, the return to the tribes, you know. It's too late, in a sense. You know. You have places, areas, yes, you can reconstruct, you know, a group of solidarity on traditional basis, you know, in Jordan, for instance, so, but not in the big cities of the Maghreb now. So there is precisely a discrepancy between the cultural anthropology that is being developed on both sides of the Mediterranean about the traditional Arab societies and the real anthropology of the Arab society, which is changing, but which is not represented neither by political actors, and that was a big defeat of the Arab Spring, that the political actors were not have not been able, you know, to root themselves in social, real social movement and things like that. And it's not represented also in the intellectual debate, which is mainly now on culturalist through the culturalist prisms and not through a real sociological and political science approach.
Thank you, Olivier, for your comments. It's quite interesting to stress. I was quite interested in your concept of secularization of moral order as a reconstruction of an image of traditional society in anthropological terms, which does not necessarily exist anymore or has never existed, perhaps a new form of creation. And it goes back to the question of a region that feels the need to return to some form of order after so much disorder, and the order is not necessarily there. It needs to be recreated, and thus postponing or putting off any space for real debate on advancement of the society and the political forms towards a more democratic order, which includes, of course, the issue of stability. I think we have quite a lot of material for discussion, and I would certainly like to open the floor to you, to your comments and questions to the panelists. And so, please.
Opposing cultures. I'm seeing the values of both and trying to figure out how to be diplomatic. I find my Roma mother, when she's told to wear trousers and Western dress, she puts on the most ugly colors and rebels. And when I let her be herself, she dresses beautifully. And so I think this is something of what's being said here. This problem of conflict, order which is imposed, that is not chosen, and so forth. That's partly the revolution.
It's a small example in a different area, and usually when we are very much into a topic or a region, we do not see. We are in the bubble. And we have to go out, look for another example from a completely different level of analysis in a completely different context, to actually, through the comparison, see the notions, the very accurate, the essential that you are talking about. And I thank you for your remark. I wanted to comment on Olivier Roy, if I may. Should I sit there as a, one of the listeners, you know, pupils, students? I just wanted to add, I'm not disagreeing with you, but I wanted to add the dimension in this neoconservatism of the imagined traditional societies, because we had imagined societies in nationalism. I mean, Benedict Anderson said that nationalism created imagined societies. These are not true bonds that are based on kinship and blood. But we decided that we are Italians, we are Egyptians, we are French, we are... And inside, we actually were so different, and sometimes linguistically even, but this nation-state umbrella embraced us, and it promised a lot and did not fulfill any of its promises. But nevertheless, we tried to convince ourselves that this was a great achievement, blah, blah, blah. Okay? But what is very important at the same time, bringing in two elements. Capitalism, that we rarely talk about. We talk about politics and society. There is an economic machine to the extent that actually one now sees, obviously, not theorizes, that the highest stage of colonialism is capitalism and not the opposite. What we see now is actually going to different countries and basically owning the land and owning the assets, and now it's not an invasion by arms, it's an invasion by capital. And this is one of the things behind the war in the region in the first place that we overlook. I mean, what is happening of forced eviction of Sinai people in Sinai under the cover of war on terrorism and this small group of ISIS that is located in Sinai is actually for reasons of selling the land to the Emiratis and the Saudis. I mean, it's very obvious, and law has been changing accordingly. I'm not inventing or accusing anything. Law has been changing. After not permitting Sinai's to own the land, now the Saudis might be, according to the law and by decree by the president, have an exception from not giving the land to non-Egyptians. I mean, there is capitalism here, so take off the mask of politics and war and war on terrorism, etc., and look into the economic dimensions as well. The second thing that has been absent from the talk is thinking, you know, the literature of thinking like a state, seeing like a state, you know, thinking like an army. This is, some regimes are not authoritarian regimes. It's unfair to call them authoritarian, unfair to authoritarianism. You know, these are military regimes. And in such societies where the military rules, the society itself and the public sphere turns into a camp. Literally, Agamben is very literal. But also you have, besides Agamben, to read Lacan. This is the patriarchal, misogynist state as well, that sees any man or any woman who is far less than a man in the eyes of the military mind as usually immoral. And I have read a lot of Facebook pages and Twitter accounts of army officers and police officers. The language they use indicates very clearly that a person that, who does not carry arms actually is less masculine, a man even. So let alone women, you know, a man who does not carry arms. So you should shut up because we are the ones who are protecting you. Those who are in the movement on the ground are usually and sometimes predominantly called the very colloquial label of the faggots or the homosexuals or, you know, so those activists who are so and so and so. The women in the movement are called prostitutes. All the time, the mentality of the camp is a masculine mentality that relates masculinity to carrying arms, to the gun. And there is a lot of sociological and psychological analysis. I don't necessarily agree with Lacan, but he was useful. Very embarrassing for me to read with my conservative background. A lot of sexualization of political discourse, etc. But he was very useful, really. So there is a component here that is very important to understand. Agamben and Lacan help us a lot. I'm sorry for the policymakers in the room who are not interested in theoretical discourse, but actually sometimes a bit of theory helps you really unveil
what is obscure. You try, what we do in political theory, is try to catch terms that express and explain. And I think this is very important as well. It's not about religion at all. It's not the story. The story is about the state, the patriarchal state that creates its own religion. It is almost a religion, the religion of the state of conservatism, of we will not allow these immoral things to happen. And the revolution becomes immoral because it is against the order. And it is always equated with disorder. There is a very interesting, on the sociological level, analysis, Richard Sennett or Zygmunt Bauman or others who talked about deconstructive order and constructive disorder, not in the American sense, you know, not in the American sense of the beginning of the millennium regarding the Middle East, but in the sociological sense, that sometimes disorder actually is constructive because it reorders the relations of power, and it is a political window of opportunity, by the way. You pay a very high price, at least get something out of it. You know, you don't have to pay the price again and again and again and again. If you face disorder and you don't have any choice in this disorder, or you maybe have pushed it a bit for the snowball to go, then try to make reorder things in a way that then would end up with a stability on a new niveau and plateau that is more just, at least, which is the struggle at the moment in the Middle East, that it would not eventually end up on a level or niveau that is lower than what we started with. And this is the whole struggle in Egypt and Tunisia.
Thank you very much to all this interesting discussion. I'm just thinking about women's situation. So it's really important. War sometimes make disorder, but really create opportunity. I was living in Afghanistan for 3 years, and just at the beginning of the end of Taliban, and was an immense opportunity for women at that time. First, because men was just at the beginning of the end of the war, so they have to reset themselves. And women, in any case, had all the past in their back, and they have to continue to feed their family. So they have more opportunity and space. After start Iraq war, all money decrease, and little by little, women decrease economy and decrease space for women. So the only option of women was not only institution, but mainly all the society, civil society, and women that still support women. Because it was very difficult that men make, we can say, a step back and give space to them. There are, but are very few. And in any case, they are not the majority now. Okay? So, it's a progress, because we should look not in 2 years, of course, but in an historical perspective. But it's really an opportunity. At that time was an opportunity. Some women come out from their situation. Some women experience some freedom, and little by little after they get back. So I can imagine that now in Tunisia, in the MENA region, we can say that women are in a position that have perhaps some opportunity. This is my question. They have more opportunity than before. In any case, they are in a process. And because civil society, and this is, I think, is happening everywhere, also in Europe. I can talk as Italian and as activist of women rights in Italy. It's more fragmented civil society. There are any more funds. There are no funds for civil society. So little by little, it's really a struggle for them to continue to be active, because there are other emergency problems. So women are less close to women, because first they are close to the women that are in the same city, they are close to them, but things that there are women in other countries that need support, it's more difficult. And this break the chain, and this make that patriarchal system that is the base of capitalism and so on, win in any case. So how women now in your region are building bridge with the other women, or are building bridge with women that can support women, or are building bridge with which society and with which men that can help them? This is my question.
Thank you very much. This is basically a follow-up to what Heba and Olivier were saying. I was just thinking about the amazing parallelisms between the processes that you're describing and what's happening in Eastern Europe. You know, new forms of authoritarianism feeding on a reconstruction of some older pre-communist nationalist family-grounded, sexual and morality order-based notion of, you know, collectivity. And so I think it's I totally agree with your reading of this, as that is, has nothing to do with religion in itself or per se. It's got to do with this, you know, cultural reconstruction. But I also think that, you know, Heba's point is key, that this is allowing a politics of identity to flourish while the economic and financial politics have been, you know, taken from the side of the nation state. This is a global order, and it's a few families around the world deciding that. And you know, deprived of that realm, what we see is identity politics flourishing, either to unite around this notion of collective self, or to, you know, create fights and say, you know, the us versus the others. But it's a distraction that basically frees the camp for neoliberal, you know, obscene forms of capitalism to take over everywhere. So I think it's you know, beautiful, and the connection to me is very clear. So this is just a comment.
A question for Dr. Rauf. You said at some point that during the collapse of the nation state in the Middle East, actually we observed that the position of women in tribes is actually better than the position of women in other areas or social groups where actually they were defined more by modernity. And I would like to ask you to give us some examples of this, or to be more concrete, in what ways is this position better? Thank you.
Sorry, there is somebody else. Perhaps Olivier, you want to make a last comment and we go.
I agree with what has been said. You know, there is this interesting contradiction that we find in every populist party. On one hand, they claim national sovereignty, closing the borders, and so and so. And on the other hand, from the economic point of view and financial point of view, they are totally more or less liberal, and they have no economic program to fight globalization, and even they play globalization, clearly, you know, everywhere. So that this discrepancy between politics of identity and economic globalization, I totally agree, totally agree. And it leads to violence, of course. And the Sinai is a very interesting example.
Nadia, thank you.
So thank you
again
for your question about opportunities for women. You're absolutely right. I think this time of disorder in Tunisia is a great opportunity, not just a challenge. Because for the first time, the myth of Tunisian state feminism has been
to
to feminism in Tunisia was the fact that the feminist agenda was constantly instrumentalized under Bourguiba and Ben Ali by the state. And you may have seen this article that was widely circulated of the Washington Post by Hind Zaki, explaining how under this supposedly democracy and feminist regime of Ben Ali, rape was actually used for 23 years by state agents as a policy of intimidation. So much for state feminism. So finally, after 2011, all this myth has broken out up, and new possibilities of feminism have emerged. The fact that Nahda is the Islamist party has the most the biggest number of female deputies compared to other parties has also been an interesting challenge to this narrative of secularism equal feminism. So there are now new narratives and new initiatives and a grassroots feminism that is finally emerging. So this is a really a fantastic opportunity, and if this new counter-revolutionary time does not succeed into suffocating this effort, I think it could produce great outcomes. Just a last point, though, I think it's important to disconnect also the issue of feminism in Tunisia from this issue of the secularist Islamist divide. There has been an overemphasis on the ideological aspect of the feminist and the gender fight, to the extent that it's been solely understood in the perspective of ideology and completely disconnected from the very obvious, more pressing issue of class. Class divide, poverty, and I think it's important in Tunisia to reconnect this issue of women to the issue of poverty and class, which is not addressed by anyone, by any of the major state feminist organizations. So locally, women do stuff, but they don't have enough means, and they still suffer from the overemphasis on ideology. And they don't care. They don't care about whether women are veiled or practicing or not. They don't care. All they care about is having structures and opportunities in order to empower women at the local level.
Yes, I do think that this order allows you to have some opportunities. And history is not unilinear. So sometimes you achieve one step forward, two steps back, and then three steps forward. So we have to be a bit patient and learn from the lessons. Thank you for joining us in the point that me and she left. Okay. No, she's there. Okay, me and Olivier elaborated. And Georgia, regarding your question about giving you examples, I think the example might be Sinai again, and also the example would be the struggle between the police and trying to arrest women in some areas. It was easier in the city to arrest girls and women in the demonstration, in the peaceful demonstrations of the Muslim Brotherhood under the intervention of the military, under the military regime, than in small towns. And women suffered in small towns. We have very famous cases of young women who were 17 and 18 who were stabbed by thugs supported by the police. Sometimes the police does not do the dirty work. They accompany with them groups of thugs, and then they let the thugs take care of the matter. And here there is a small war. Like I spotted for the first time most of the clashes between the police and the demonstrators and the opposition and the contentious politics spaces were the cosmopolis, basically. I mean, Alexandria, Cairo, Mansoura, you know, the basic cities, especially in the north. The south is different because we have in the south tribes. If the police kills a person, then the whole tribe is going to take revenge. And this happened in Luxor. You know, the police tortured in the police station a person, and the whole of Luxor second day was on the street, and the Minister of Interior had to fly and apologize and confirm that this police officer who killed the man under torture in the police station will be charged, and then they calmed people. But in Cairo, this does not happen. A whole neighborhood does not come, except if the neighborhood is actually the informal habitats where they actually act like tribes, because they consume. I mean, Mataria, for example, though it's not really an informal habitat, but it's like an old semi-informal area, they call themselves the state of Mataria. You know, and it's very hard for the police to go in. And even some of the ultras of different football clubs who are sometimes very, very aggressive, you know, they say when it comes to Mataria, we don't care. We support each other as ultras across fans groups. You know, so if anybody's touched from Mataria, everybody joins the ultras and it's a front of ultras. They don't care which football group he belongs to, and it becomes really violent sometimes as well. So now the state is going to towns and is going to rural areas to make these fights. It tried in Sinai, by the way, at the checkpoints to bodily check women with the face veil, because in some of the tribal areas women cover their face like in like the Burda of Afghanistan. It's traditional, but it's religious as well, okay? So they started asking them to put their hands on their bodies in front of them. They didn't touch them, but they said, put your hands here, tighten your clothes so that I can see if you're carrying guns or something. This happened in 2-3 cases, and then they stopped, because it's obvious that they got signals from the tribes that don't do this with women, you know? And not a single woman has been arrested in Sinai accused of terrorism. You know, because it will. I mean, there is a nice book by Ahmed. I don't remember his name. The Thistle and the Drone, Akbar Ahmed, about how the military interventions of the Americans in Afghanistan, back to the Afghanistan to compare cases, actually fostered and strengthened the tribes, especially the drone. The use of drones, how the tribes actually had to develop their own solidarity networks and to develop their own techniques to actually defend themselves against drone wars. And they became stronger. They did not become weaker. So on different fronts, there are fights now to twist the arm of the society to accept some of the things related to violation of rights of women. And it's very uncommon. I mean, we have not witnessed before such a number of women being detained or forceful disappearance as well. We have 9 girls who have disappeared. We don't know where they are. We have now around between 50 and 90 women in detention or who faced military courts. And on and off, girls have been inside and outside the prison. The total number is about 3,000. So there is also a war going on the urban, tribal, cosmopolitan front, and the state is trying to push the limits, and sometimes it gets more resistance, and it is insisting. We have a record of 10 villages that have been encirculated by police forces. They went in, arrested people, shot people, killed civilians, and they retreated. It's almost like they are training for a civil war. And it's frightening if you see the record of, this did not happen in Egypt before. The clashes used to be in Mahalla with the labor movement, or in Cairo with the Kefaya movement in the 10 years ago. But it didn't take place in villages where people actually are expected to fight back. Because of the media and the totalitarian culture, people started like, this is none of our business. And it's a fight now on that front between the state and the community. And we will see. In some areas where the tribes are present, in southern Egypt and in Sinai, society has been trying to defend as much as it could. In areas in the urban space, we are the orphans of the modernity. There are no networks, and when we are caught as individuals. And individuality is actually the word that describes what Olivier was talking about. The military regimes do not accept manifestations of individuality, even if they are part of a religious reformation discourse, or if they are definitely sexual orientation, or if they are about individual choices. I mean, many of the youth who have been caught by police in clashes, they razored their head, and they now identified revolutionary young men by beard and long hair. So they take them from their hair and say, okay, now we're gonna razor your head. You know, it's this image of who is a man, you know, and this dimension is very clear in day-to-day verbal exchanges, expressions, attitudes, And this rising sexual abuse of men, not of women, in police stations is very clear, like you're not a man. The last incident was a week ago when a police officer had a fight with a cab, like a mini collective cabs that are like small buses that are in the streets of Cairo. He had a verbal disagreement with him, and he shot him, I don't know what you call it, in his genitals, and he said, I will turn you into a woman. And it was so clear. It crystallized the Lacanian notion of what it means to have a pistol and what it means to face a citizen, that, okay, you are now arguing with me, I will turn you into a woman, and he shot him in his genitals. It's far beyond authoritarianism. This is something completely far beyond authoritarianism.
Well, thank you, Eba. Perhaps as a last remark, I would say that in spite of all the dire pictures that we have been describing and listening to, there is one line, silver line at the end. This is what has been said, is the opportunities that are perhaps still there in a state of deep disorder, and the situation that is clearly very bad at many fronts. There is always the opportunity that this is a phase through which a new order might emerge and might also include elements that we all desire for the region. So thank you very much for participating at the panel, and thank you.
Test. Okay.
So hello and welcome to everyone. I'm actually not Laura Lee Downs. Laura is a dear colleague of mine, and something happened to her. And I'm sure she will be here in a few minutes. But I think it's a pity to lose the time, the precious time. We have such a distinguished a group of people here, and it's such an important topic. So I would just say let's go ahead and get going. And as soon as Laura comes, I'll let her use the seat to pull this all together. Had you already agreed on
there must be an order?
An order? Was there any agreement on that, Claire? No? Okay, then I will ask my colleague Claire Kilpatrick to hit it off.
Yeah.
And then we will proceed. Eccola. There she is. Okay. There she is. Laura, we were missing you. We were worried about you. Okay.
No, sorry, I was outside.
Did you have a merger? You were supposed to speak anymore?
No, I didn't actually. I had an allergy attack on the way up the hill.
We're interpreters. I'm sorry, you probably don't even know that we're supposed to be here, but we are.
I do. You are Laura, right?
Yes. Nice to meet you.
Please excuse my lateness. I had a rather bad allergy attack coming up the hill. So Claire Kilpatrick is going to start, and if we have some time at the end, I have a few comments also, but first of all, I want to hear from our speakers.
So. Maybe you want to sit here.
Well, I can just speak to this.
Do you have?
If you switch off your mic,
this is on. Mic.
If you switch off yours. Oops. Okay. Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for coming along to this panel on employment and social affairs. I'm a professor here in the law department. And Laura, as the panel chair, she asked me to talk about women in euro crisis. So that's what I'm going to say a few things about this morning. Now, as many of you will know, since 2008, a large number of European member states have suffered a series of distinct, though connected, crises: financial crisis, economic crisis, and sovereign debt crisis. Now, some of these crises have had a gender impact, which I'll explore in a second, simply through the market effects they produced. However, and importantly, in seven EU member states, those seven EU member states which had sovereign debt loan assistance, the first eastern wave of Latvia, Romania and Hungary, and the second wave of Greece, Ireland, Portugal and Cyprus, gender impact also, and indeed primarily, came through loan conditions imposed by the EU institutions and the IMF. Now, these loan conditions typically required, often repeatedly, public sector redundancies and wage cuts, cuts to social spending, and cuts to rights at work. And in addition, in Italy and Spain, we have a more complex story, but also some forms of EU conditionality being applied to those states. So let me just take you on a little, somewhat depressing tour first of the gender impact of these various crises and give you a few examples. First thing to look at is the impact of cuts in public sector jobs and wages on women in Europe. Now, this is pretty obvious connection because of women's reliance on public sector employment. So women account for almost 70% of public sector workers in the EU. So in Ireland, where there was a special deal between unions and the government, there were significant public sector wage cuts, which had a very significant impact on women in the public sector. And in Greece, where we still have an ongoing programme, of course, public sector wages were first reduced by at least 20% and for some workers by up to 50%. And it's very important to note the cumulative impact of these measures. So in 2013, 25,000 public sector workers in Greece were put into a labour reserve, and at the end of a certain period, many of them were dismissed. So public sector cuts had a major, major impact on women over in recent years. A second issue to look at is female unemployment. Now, the gender differential of unemployment during the crises varies across EU member states, though I won't go into that in more detail. It's important to remember that women's unemployment is often unreported against men's. Women are much less often publicly registered as unemployed. But the most striking gender differentials in unemployment in Europe, again, come from Greece. So pre-crisis in 2007, Eurostat records male unemployment as around 5%, female unemployment around 12.9%. But in 2014, these are the latest figures, male unemployment is 24%, female unemployment over 30%. In addition, the very high youth unemployment that we see in many countries in Europe also exhibits important gender differentials. So the Greek labour force organisation notes that female youth unemployment, i.e. those between 15 and 24, is double that of male youth unemployment in an overall context where youth unemployment is over 50%. So these are really scary figures. A third issue is cuts in public services. And it's very important to think about the gender impact of these. So cuts to childcare, cuts to the hours of school opening, cuts to new measures, for example, in Spain, that gave care allowance and child benefit to those who stayed at home looking after family members. This was a great new law introduced in 2006 and basically abolished in 2012. And this gave women access to a pension and some security, even when they cared for somebody at home. So there has also been radical cuts to healthcare expenditure across many of these countries, so that now up to a third of the Greek population is without any healthcare insurance. So just underlying, this means that an uninsured pregnant woman has to bear the full cost of abortion, antenatal care, and delivery of her child when she is uninsured. A further important area of cuts that has major equality implications is dramatic cuts to funding for gender equality bodies and cuts to programs that help combat violence against women in Europe. So in Ireland, very many public and statutory bodies which were specifically designed to promote gender equality were restructured or closed down from the beginning of the crisis. NGOs in Spain, Portugal, Cyprus, Greece have all raised concerns with regard to cuts in public funding for women's organisations and equality bodies. And in Cyprus, for example, the equality body had their funding halved during the crisis. So these are just typical things that are going on. Now, overall, this tells us a tale of dramatically reduced economic resources for women and increased vulnerability for women in Europe today. And just to underline this, in 2012, 45% of women in Greece were living below the poverty threshold. So these are, I think, really striking things that we need to consider. Okay, I'm going to stop. However, I think it's about much more than that, because we can see that many reinforcing drivers of economic independence, autonomy, gender equality are being affected by euro crisis. In particular, cutbacks to public services mean that services are transferred back inside the household, and that means to whom inside the household? Moreover, many of these changes have very long-term effects, and here I would like to underline the huge changes to pension entitlements that have taken place across Europe, which means women will have to work for much longer for a much lower pension. Now, if I had more time, which I don't, so I'm going to stop, but we can talk about it later. I wanted to tell you something more hopeful, which is about the mobilisation of women's organisations in Europe and also trade unions and how they have mobilised against these measures using constitutional courts, European human rights sources and the UN Convention on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women. And there we see some really interesting and important new kinds of female woman mobilisation going on in Europe. So I'm telling you, there's some little bit of hope, but I want to give some time to the rest of the panel, so I'm going to stop here. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much, Claire, for that. Okay, we have some technical difficulties here.
Desktop, upload yours.
Desktop. While Juan is searching for his presentation, let me just introduce him to you. This is Juan Dolado, who is a professor of economics at the EUI. His fields of research are labor economics and econometrics, and he's the former president of the Spanish Economic Association, and he received the prize Jaime I in 2015, which was awarded by the King of Spain for highly significant contributions in social sciences. And his most recent publication is the book optimistically titled No Country for Young People, Youth Labor Market Problems in Europe, which came out last year. I believe our technical difficulties have been resolved. And so thank you, Juan.
Thanks a lot. I'm going to talk briefly about what is being called the grand convergence in gender achievements in Europe over the Great Recession. So I'll try to put up two ideas to later on discuss during after the talks. What's going on here? Okay, so first, the gender wage gap. The gender wage gap is probably the best measurement of distance between genders, because it represents the productivity, the lifetime achievements in the labor market. So the first signal of the gender wage gap or the gender pay gap goes back to the Leviticus, where if you read the quotation there, it said that a woman is worth 30 shekels against a man's value, which is 50 shekels. So you divide 30 by 50, this gives rise to 60%, which was very persistent as a gender gap until basically the 1950s, after the Second World War. So that was a very good prediction. Later on, it became 80%, 85%, so I'm comparing female wages with male wages, due to convergence in human capital, less occupational segregation, inroads of women in employment and labor force participation over the life cycle, more tests by women in competition, better bargaining power, etc., etc. Well, I can expand on that later on. So these are just graphs, just to get a quick glance at them. This is trends in employment of working age women. So this is between 15 and 64. And basically you can see this is since the after war period, 1950 to now to 2010. What you can see is an upward trend. So female are making inroads in the labor market. When you look at the gender gap, so this is the proportion of the male wage that the female wage represents. Well, you see it's also an upper trend, but in some of the countries, it's reached a sort of plateau. So what has happened to this 80%, which has been achieved since the Leviticus over the Great Recession? Well, here, what you can see is a graph where in the horizontal axis, you have the wage changes before the Great Recession, which I take to be since the beginning of the new century to 2007, like the onset. And here what you have is the wage gap change after the Great Recession, which I take from 2007 to 2012. What you see is a diversity of experiences. So if a point is above, this is the 45 degree line, so if a point is on the 45 degree line, it means that the change has been the same. If it is above, the change has been larger. If it is below, the change has been lower. So you can see that there are some countries which have moved towards convergence, like the ones in the upper cycle, whereas some other countries have lagged. So you will have a diversity of experiences that we would like to address. So what has happened to women and men? Here you have a similar graph where you have the male employment rate change. So the change over the Great Recession versus the female employment rate. Employment rate is employment divided by people in working age. So what you can see basically, and this is the labor force participation. So how many men and women are looking for job, the change in labor force participation. So what you can see is in both outcomes, women have fared much better than men, even though, of course, negative values means that there have been job losses, but for females have been much lower than for men. Okay, so this is for the EU countries as a whole. Then what happens to the pay gaps of the recession? Well, this graph shows the employment rates. So for instance, 50% unemployment rate means that among those within the working age population, 15 to 64, only 50 have a job, are employed. And here what you have is just the gap between female and male. So this is just a proportion that male wages are above female wages. Well, what you can see is that in Europe, somewhat surprisingly, the southern countries, the sort of olive belt countries, have gender gaps which are much lower than in the northern countries. So here you have UK, of course you have US as a comparison, the Netherlands, Germany, Austria. Here you have Greece, Spain, Italy, and Portugal. How can that be? We tend to think that social norms are less favorable in the southern countries. Well, there is a very simple explanation, which is in the southern countries, female participation is much lower, again, due to social norms. So if those women who select themselves into the labor market have favorable characteristics, somewhat under inverted commas are better, you are comparing the best women to the average men, because men participate always. They have rates of participation which are about 100%. So this is an exercise where I correct for these selection biases. And what you tend to see, the first column is the gaps that I gave you before. So 11% in Greece or 10% in Spain against 33% in the US or 25% in the UK or 19% in Germany. The last line is once you correct for these participation biases, so once you impute a wage to all those women who are not participating, and that's a technical issue, well, what you see is that the gaps in the South tend to be of the same order of magnitude or even higher, that is, in the North. Okay? So what has happened? This was just before the Great Recession. So what has happened with selection into the labor market during the Great Recession? Well, two things have happened. In most of the Southern countries, sectors which are intensive in less skilled labor, think of construction, personal services, etc., and which tend to be male dominated, have suffered a huge job shedding. So, under inverted commas, the men with the worst production characteristics have been left out of the market. So, selection now has become important among men, whereas before it was not important because all men were participating. What has happened to women? Well, the partners say of these men who lost their jobs in the less skilled sectors enter the labor market. This is what in economists call the added worker effect, just to make up for the loss of income as a result of the husband getting unemployed. So this means that women with less good production characteristics enter the labor market. So as a result, now selection is less of a female issue and it's more of a male issue. What would happen to the gender gap in those cases? Well, now the male wage is going to be upward biased because you are taking away from the labor market those with the lower wages. Okay, because they are all on the dole, they are all unemployed. Whereas for women, the less skilled women are entering the labor market, so the gender gap is going to increase purely as a result of these changes in selection. So finally, and that's what is left? I mean, this is I found that yesterday on the web, and I thought it was a great photograph to illustrate the gender gap. Okay. So we've moved. Since the Leviticus from 60 to 80, when is 100% going to take place? Well, economists, sociologists, political scientists have been looking for the determinants of this gap and how to correct them. And to me, I mean, what is called the final item, the final chapter in the grand convergence, which is going to lead us from 80% to 100%. Is the rigidity in work schedules, okay? And the non-linear pay schedules. So there are occupations where built-in flexibility is absent. So there is no way of substituting one person for another. Here, and this is the end of my presentation, what you have is, I took quite a large number of occupations, 400 occupations, and I classify them in terms of rigidity of working schedule. So these are rigid occupations. I lump them together into four sectors: health, business, technology, science, and other. Other are lawyers, etc. And what you can see here, you have the size of the gender gap. Here you have occupations which are very rigid, occupations which are more flexible. What you can see with this line is that the gender pay gaps tends to be much, much lower in those occupations which allow for more flexibility. So to me, this is the key issue. I mean, all the other gender policies which have been tried have managed to narrow the gap, but here we have a pending one. So I think I'll stop here.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Juan, for
a fascinating presentation and for giving us some concrete statistics and material to chew on. Our next speaker, continuing the musical chairs game, is Fabrizio Bernardi, who holds the chair in sociology at the EUI's Social and Political Sciences Department, where he has also been awarded the dubious privilege of being chair of the department recently. His most recent book, which just came out, is titled Education, Occupation, and Social Origin, a Comparative Analysis of the Transmission of Socioeconomic Inequalities. He also has two key publications that are particularly relevant to today's panel. First is titled, and I love this title, Does the Husband Matter? Married Women's Employment in Italy, which came out in the European Sociological Review in 1999, and also his monograph, Donne fra Famiglia e Carriera, Strategie di Coppia e Vincoli Sociali, published by Franco Angeli in 1999. So thank you for joining the panel.
No, thank you for inviting me to take part to this panel. So you see the title of my presentation, so I'm going to discuss the issues of gender equality and to connect it to some other issues in the study of socio-economic inequalities, and in particular, I try to connect gender equality to social mobility, that means an intergenerational inequality, that means the way in which advantage is transmitted from one generation to the other. And so I take a broader look, and somehow I will discuss in these 5 minutes possibly some unintended consequences associated to the increase of gender equality. So, let me start simply with a graph, and in this graph you can see the rate of people with a university degree for different birth cohort in US. The blue line refers to men, the red line refers to women, and this graph that is for the US, but it shows a pattern that is common to, let's say, all Western society, I will show a graph for Italy in a while, show us a process of convergence over the last centuries so that women catch up. And actually, at the end of the process, the rate of tertiary university attainment is higher for women when compared to men. So this is US. This is a graph for Italy. The red bar are women. The blue bar are men. And you see similar pattern. Men, educational expansion starts earlier for men. And then women follow up, catch up, and at the end of the process, we have a higher proportions of women with a university degree when compared to men. So this graph, the pattern that this educational expansion and catching up for men and women can be considered as one of the driver, or maybe the driver of the convergence in labor force participation, possibly in the gender gap that Juan was pointing to before. So this is one of the drivers. However, in parallel to this convergence, other things took place in these decades and are partly associated to this parallel increase and in the number of highly educated men and highly educated women. First of all, the proportions of highly educated couple has increased. So highly educated homogamous couple have become more common out of also this increase in the proportions of people who are highly educated. And also, these couples are more stable. In the past, highly educated women were more likely to divorce when compared to low educated women, and now this gradient has changed, particularly in the US, but also in most European countries. So there are more highly educated couples, and they are more stable. A second, I cannot show the data, but in general, we know that highly educated couples are more able to transmit their privilege, their resources, their socioeconomic resources, their cultural resources to their kids, because there are two highly educated parents in one family, so they are in a better position when compared to a situation where there is only one highly educated parent. And on the top of that, there are also hints that parenting has changed, and in recent decades, it has become more intensive, more aggressive, if you want, among couples where both parents are highly educated. So the consequences of this, the fact that there are more highly educated couples, more stable, and more able to transmit their advantage to the next generation, is that possibly the degree of similarity in parents' children's socioeconomic position has increased over time. So And so the idea is that socioeconomic immobility increase. And now I show a graph that is somehow based on some joint work with a postdoc here and a researcher, Gorday and Florian. So this is again for US, and this is tentative, and it shows the bars refer to the proportions of children who have the same level of education in US, simply with a dichotomy university degree, not a university degree or lower. So you see that in the past, this proportion was very high. These are the cohorts who become 30s in 1920. So these are cohorts born at the end of the 19th century. So about 70% of the people had a very high level of at the same level of education as their parents. And this was a situation where only 5% of the people went to the university. Okay? And you see that there is this U-shape, or it's not really U-shape, J-shape curve, so that this proportion is increasing again. The immobility is increasing again, but the situation now is radically different. So the high level of immobility at the beginning of the century took place in a situation where very few people went to the university. And now this reversal is taking place in a situation where a lot of people, about 30, 40% of people are going to the university. For this reason, we try to apply this idea that we are moving from a low educational attainment immobility equilibrium to a high educational attainment immobility equilibrium. So, and one of the underlying driver of this increase again of immobility is the fact that educational distributions of parents and children have become more similar, but also distributions of men and women have become more similar. So I just want to conclude quickly that we observe an increase in gender equality in income, as Juan was showing, in some countries, in labor force participation, in housework, in highly educated couples. But this increase in gender inequality might go hand in hand, so I'm cautious here, I'm not talking about causality, even if there might be some underlying mechanism, with a larger inequality among children of high and low educated parents with less mobility, and also possibly a larger inequality among highly educated women and low educated women. So we have got more gender equality among the successful highly educated couples and possibly an increase in inequality among women. So just as a final remark, so this is in no way a message that, I don't want to convey the message that we should question gender equality, not at all. I'm just suggesting that we should probably have a broader look at this issue and also not to forget that if we want to address gender equality, we should also address other issues and possibly gender socioeconomic inequality in a broader sense. Okay, I'm done.
Thank you very much, Fabrizio. I actually will have some things to say about this at the end of our panel. I think this is a very important finding and one that we need to think about, how the class and gender dynamics of inequality have functioned over time. But before we get to that very knotty little issue, I would like to introduce Ekaterina Vorozhdina, excuse me if I've massacred your name, who is a research fellow at the Gender Studies Program, at the European University at St. Petersburg. And her research interests include the professionalization of midwifery in Russia and the sociology of care. And some recent publications include The Social Organization of Natural Birth, the case of the Center for Midwifery Care, which was published in the Journal of Social Policy Studies in 2014, and The Language of Love and the Language of Science, the Legitimation of Independent Midwifery Practice in Russia, which came out in Laboratorium in 2014. Thank you for being with us today.
Thank you. I would like to turn to a bit another part of Europe, and particularly to Russia, and to another set of problems, to problems related to intersections of family policy and women's position at labor markets, and also a bit to a different methodology to qualitative studies and to understanding changes in relations between the state and the citizens and changes in gender citizenship in contemporary Russia related to family politics. So since the mid-200s, Russian authorities become preoccupied with the decline in fertility rates, which was framed like dying out of the nations. And 2006 and 2007 was a time of introducing different social programs aimed at stimulating women to give birth to more children. And the flagship of these reforms was the maternity capital program, which was a subsidy, a monetary subsidy for women who give birth at least to two children. And actually, this program and this set of measures, it singled out the major shift in social policy. So that was about providing those citizens who comply with the state reproductive norms with these monetary incentives. And I intend to consider the differences between the state perspective and the citizens' perspective on this reform. So if we are talking about the state, we can say that these reforms reflects the consistency of contemporary Russian family policy with those of the Soviet Union and Soviet-style policy. So it is consistent, first, in the matter that it resembles a Soviet-style gender traditionalism, because women are still perceived in the country as the main care providers and as the natural care providers, and thus the changes in reproductive health rates are meant to be change through stimulating women to give birth to more children. And second, the state can still consider itself as a provider of paternalistic care to women and as the main welfare provider in this sphere of family care. And however, one must mention the differences from the state Soviet policy, because contemporary regime seems to be even more traditionalist than the Soviet one. First of all, it fails to address issues of reconciliation of work and family, because even at the very beginning of the program in 2006, in the president's address, it was officially proclaimed that the states introduced this program as the measure to compensate women for their losses at labor market, because women who give birth to two children in Russia, typically withdrawn from the labor market for around 6 years. And there is a significant lack of institutional support for work and family balance in the country. And this program was criticized both by the experts and both by the citizens themselves for providing monetary subsidies instead of institutional support. And again, there is also a lack of institutional support for fatherhood and for fathers to reconcile their parental obligations and their work. So that's again, this again pushes women from the labor market to their maternity role. And what's more, the state policy in this sphere is inconsistent. So the state actually fails to be fully paternalistic and assess to state support policy measures. It's very difficult for women. It's related to many bureaucratic hurdles with them. To them, so by 2012, only one-third of women eligible to these huge benefits really were able to receive them. And if we look at this situation from the viewpoint from the woman itself, it's interesting to know that women do not question states' right to influence their reproductive behavior and to intervene in this intimate sphere. Women are ready to quit labor markets in order to give birth to more children to fulfill this like citizen's duty. However, on the other hand, it should be noted that women are not Russian women are not that like passive Soviet subjects, because they are intent to tear out their benefits from the state. So they criticize the state for being inconsistent in its policy, and they, especially middle class women, so they try to overcome these bureaucratic cuddles and get their benefits from this state. And also, one should note the differences between regions in the country and the meaning that this policy have for the different groups of women, because this amount of money which is provided by the state, it is substantial for those women who reside in smaller cities. However, those women who reside in these cities have more difficult access to the benefits. And actually, the main addresses of this family policy and its changes happen to be professional middle-class women who are able to deal with bureaucratic difficulties and who can use this money. So that's all. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that fascinating presentation. As a historian of France, this all sounds eerily familiar to rather coercive programs introduced in the early 20th century. So I think there are many, many interesting themes that cross the continent, particularly when it comes to controlling women's reproductive capacity. I would like to now pass the floor to Elena, and I really am going to massacre your name, I'm sorry, Zdravomyslova, who is Doctor of Sociology and professor at the European University at St. Petersburg, where she is also co-director of the Gender Studies Program. Her recent publications include two articles that are particularly relevant to today's panel. First, Making and Managing Class, Employment of Paid Domestic Workers in Russia, which came out in Rethinking Class in Russia, edited by Suvi Salmeniemi, and which was published in 2012 by Ashgate. She's also the author of Working Mothers and Nannies, The Commercialization of Childcare and Modifications in the Gender Contract, which came out in Anthropology of East Europe Review in 2010. Thank you very much for joining us, Elena.
Thank you for having me here. And I was thinking why I am here, why we came here, me and Katya from St. Petersburg, and you are discussing here European Union, and it is kind of strange for us. But then we thought that it is kind of solidarity on gender issues. And of course, there are a lot of issues of gender inequality which we share there in Russia with European Union. And maybe this focus will be of interest for you. And I'm extremely intrigued by one particular aspect of gender inequality which becomes more and more articulate in recent times, and it is gender gap not in earnings but in pension. And this will be grow and grow. And the European Union politics is very sensitive to these issues because the life course approach is integrated in the policies and research on women. And I think it is very necessary for us as researchers, as intellectuals, first of all, to put forward the methodological principle of intersectionality. We should speak not only about men and women and gender divide, as sometimes statistics helps us to do, but we have to think more concretely about women of different age groups or in different periods of life cycle, about class, ethnicity, race, gender, and social citizenship. And it will give us very different pictures. So this is just the statement that I would like to follow, to suggest and to develop. Here, keeping in mind this idea of intersectionality, I would like to raise two aspects of women's questions dealing with the women's work as caregivers, paid and unpaid. And I claim that this naturalization and taking as normal caring work of women is really the reason for the gender gap in pension, which will be growing and growing with the aging of society. So I'm a researcher, and my research focus in the current years is care work. One research was focused on migrant care work in Russia, on paid domestics who come to Russian families from the former Soviet Union republics to emancipate women of middle classes and to help them to combine professional work and family chores. The second, so they are paid caregivers, migrant workers, and my focus was on Central Asia, which is one of those labor pools that provide caregivers for the Russian well-offs and helps to construct social class within gender division. My second focus, also based on the research I'm currently involved in with my colleagues, is on the sandwich generation syndrome in the Russian situation. You probably know what is it about. It is a sandwich generation or pivot generation. This is all about the life situation of women in the middle age who are squeezed between two patterns, two types of responsibilities, usually. Between the responsibilities of care over their children, because they still need support, they are not still independent because of demographic changes. And the second type of responsibility is care over elderly parents who become dependent on their concrete practices of caregiving. This sandwich generation syndrome is extremely gendered because in society I belong to, it is women's responsibility to take care of the elderly as well as the young. And in Russian, and I think that in every society, in spite of many common features, there is specific sandwich syndrome. For example, in Russia, this syndrome is shaped by the fact that women combine double responsibilities in caring with the paid work. Yes, and sometimes with caring over grandchildren. So the burdens are more and more here. But this care work is not taken into account by politicians in the Russian case. Balance between work and care for mothers and younger families, I see it. If it is really this balance is supported by institutions, the burdens of sandwich generations really are not supported. It is taken as natural care, as work which is not problematized by politicians, but not by the families. So the fact that women continue to do domestic work of caring, and the fact that migrant women very often work in shadow economy as caregivers in Russian family, produce the effect of gender gap in pension because their work is not recorded. This is the message, and I'm finishing. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that welcome call to intersectional analysis, which I think you're absolutely right is central to understanding what's happening today. Finally, it's a great pleasure to present Laura Ajea, who is a member of parliament and who will speak to us, I believe, in Italian, but we have a simultaneous translator, so.
Buongiorno a tutti. Io sono Laura Ajea, sono deputata al Parlamento europeo. E faccio parte della Commissione per l'occupazione e gli affari sociali e per le libertà e i diritti civili. È un piacere essere qua e raccontarvi come al legislatore politico, perché questo è il ruolo che abbiamo all'interno del Parlamento europeo, spetta un compito non sicuramente semplice, quello di poter essere e di poter fare una sintesi di quello di cui abbiamo sentito parlare dai relatori precedenti. L'abilità, la bravura, la visione che dovrebbe avere un politico nel suo più alto compito di legiferare è quello di creare una sintesi che abbia una visione e sappia in qualche modo inserire all'interno della legislazione europea in questa strana forma di codecisione quello che è l'interesse prioritario di integrare i diritti delle donne all'interno di un contesto odierno che è estremamente complicato e che molto spesso esclude le donne. Credo che...
Prego. So, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Laura Ajea. I'm a member of the European Parliament. It's a great pleasure for me to be here, and I'm a member of the Committee on Employment and for Social Affairs, as well as the Committee for Civil Liberties. As I was saying, it is a pleasure for me to be here, and it's also quite difficult to explain, or maybe it isn't, that the legislator has indeed a very, very difficult task, in that it is up to the legislator to sum up all those different viewpoints which we've just heard about today, and to grasp different aspects, glean them all, and then produce a vision of what should be enshrined in European legislation. All of this according to the rather peculiar co-decision process, and establishing certain priorities, which of course take the rights of women into account, rights which are particularly complicated in this rather difficult world of ours.
Io credo che quando si parla di diritti, se sono tali, non dovremmo continuamente ribadirli. E quella che è invece la sensazione nel mio ruolo all'interno della Commissione Occupazione è che continuamente ci troviamo a rivendicare per le donne un ruolo e un posto che in realtà non dovrebbe essere che uno stato di fatto. E quindi la riflessione è che fin quando saremo a chiedere un diritto, saremo anche ad affermare che quel diritto nella sostanza non è rispettato né tantomeno applicato.
But I must admit that rights, when if we have to talk about rights at all, it probably means that somewhere these rights aren't respected, aren't abided by. And if we have to keep on reiterating this, well, then one gets the impression, and this is the impression I have on the Employment Committee, that we still have to claim women's rights and ensure that they are given their place. All of this should be a foregone conclusion, but this is not at all the case.
All'interno del nostro lavoro in Commissione Occupazione ci siamo trovati in questi primi due anni della nuova legislatura a lavorare in particolare in un documento sul congedo parentale e di come questo diritto, per esempio, alla maternità e alla necessità per una donna di poter conciliare la propria vita lavorativa con quella familiare sia ad oggi qualcosa che crea quei vulnus, quei gap fondamentali tra uno stato di diritto e uno stato di realtà. Laddove il contesto europeo nel quale ci troviamo ad operare sta determinando una crisi economica e come giustamente diceva Claire prima, danneggia in particolare le classi più vulnerabili, le donne, di conseguenza i bambini. Questo è stato un lavoro che la collega Maria Arena, deputata del gruppo SND, ha portato avanti in collaborazione con noi, dove abbiamo cercato di stabilire e di affermare con forza che esiste la necessità di concedere alle donne da una parte il diritto alla maternità, ma di poterlo conciliare anche con le proprie aspirazioni lavorative. E questo, credetemi, è estremamente complicato. Se consideriamo per esempio il contesto italiano, ci troviamo di fronte a una carenza in questa fattispecie di diritto, poiché se una donna oggi esce dal contesto lavorativo per un periodo più o meno lungo per l'accudimento di un figlio, per la propria maternità, il suo reingresso all'interno del mondo del lavoro è un percorso ad ostacoli, dove non è data la possibilità di riaccedere in maniera con gli stessi diritti al mercato del lavoro rispetto a quando ne è uscita. E questo in un contesto europeo che non solo sta invecchiando, ma dove la natalità e il diritto quindi alla genitorialità viene eroso costantemente.
Well, I've been on the Employment Committee for the past 2 years, and we've been working in this new Parliament on a document on parental leave. And we've had occasion at many a meeting to discuss the principle of maternity, maternal leave, the right of the woman to reconcile her professional life with her family life. And I can assure you that there is still a gap between the rule of law and what should be, and what we actually observe in reality. And of course, this in a European context in which there's a recession, and as Claire was quite rightly pointed out, what happens? The most vulnerable people are the ones to suffer most, the women and children. We have been working along with Maria Arena, who's from the Socialist Democrat group, on these issues, and we've been trying to reassert the principle according to which it is really necessary to recognize the right to maternity to women, and they should also be able to reconcile their private expectations with their professional ambitions. But I can assure you this is still a very complicated process. And if we were to take Italy by way of an example, I can tell you that if a woman leaves her job to look after a child for a given period, it will be very difficult for her to come back to the labour market. There are many obstacles which are put in her way. Access to the employment market is more difficult when she comes back to the labour market than when she first entered it. And this in a context in which the population in Europe is aging and the birth rate is also going down.
Mi avvio verso la conclusione dicendo che l'obiettivo primario anche di questa legislatura europea, di questa nuova legislatura che si era data da qui al 2020, era di ridurre drasticamente la povertà in Europa. Oggi siamo nella condizione di dire che non solo l'Europa non sta uscendo dalla povertà, ma se prima parlavamo di un semplice rischio di povertà, oggi parliamo di grave deprivazione. In termini forse più semplici potremmo parlare di povertà assoluta. Ci sono milioni di cittadini europei che, in particolare donne, bambini e anziani, che vivono in questa condizione. Ci sono zone dell'Europa, i paesi soprattutto dell'Eurozona, dove la povertà è ancora più evidente e manifesta. Io faccio parte di un gruppo di monitoraggio della Commissione Occupazione in Grecia, e quello che abbiamo riscontrato, visto con i nostri occhi, in un paese che è accanto al nostro e dovrebbe in qualche maniera far parte del nostro universo europeo, le condizioni sono oltre la sostenibilità. Non solo parliamo di povertà assoluta, parliamo di un rifiorire, per esempio, di malattie infantili che sembravano debellate, il rachitismo infantile da malnutrizione, l'impossibilità per i genitori di poter nutrire i figli, tanto che gli insegnanti portano cibo a scuola ai bambini, piuttosto che la prostituzione infantile. Sono fenomeni che si collocano in un contesto che è il nostro. E il legislatore europeo, il mio compito dovrebbe essere quello di poter trovare soluzioni. Ad oggi le politiche economiche, i vincoli e tutte quelle che sono state le manovre per salvare l'euro in realtà hanno dimostrato un assoluto fallimento, perché si sono andati a tagliare completamente i diritti sociali, le garanzie sociali, l'assistenza anche essenziale all'infanzia, ai disabili. Parliamo di istituti che dovrebbero occuparsi di bambini disabili chiusi e dove l'assistenza è ridotta ai minimi termini. Oggi dovremmo occuparci di queste nuove povertà e dovremmo avere un occhio di riguardo e di cura per un universo, in particolare quello della donna, che non solo non è ancora ad oggi il centro del nostro lavoro, ma che vive ai margini e che con sé porta anche l'universo infantile, che di riflesso viene danneggiato gravemente dalle politiche economiche. Concludo.
Just to go on to my conclusion. The objective which we set out for ourselves at the beginning of this legislature, thinking of the years up to the year 2020, was that we were going to drastically reduce poverty in Europe. In actual fact, in reality, we can't even talk about that anymore. We have to really think in terms of a risk which is far greater now. We have to think in terms of serious deprivation and absolute poverty. There are many parts of Europe where there is such absolute poverty, for where women, children and the older members of society suffer in particular, particularly in the regions of the Eurozone. This is even more evident. I'm part of a monitoring group which deals with the situation in Greece. Greece being a neighbouring country, part of the European universe, and here the conditions are simply no longer sustainable. Not only do we have to speak in terms of absolute poverty, but indeed children are suffering from diseases which we thought had vanished from the European scene. A bone disease due to malnutrition, for instance. Teachers bring food to school because the children haven't got enough to eat at home. Their parents simply can't afford to feed them properly. Phenomena such as child prostitution are reappearing on the scene. And all of this is part of the world we live in. And what are we supposed to do as European legislators? We're the people who are supposed to be able to find the solutions to these problems. But it seems to me that all the maneuvers, all the measures which have been taken to save the euro have indeed been a total failure. And I think that social rights have diminished as a result of these measures, social guarantees, childcare has reduced, institutions for people with disabilities have had to close down, services have been whittled down in this area. There's a whole new poverty phenomenon, which we really must try to address. And against that backdrop, there is a role of women which is far from being a central role on the labour market. She's being kept very much at the margins of society, and with her, society is, or she is taking her children with her, and all of this due to the inappropriate economic policies which I believe have been implemented over the past few years, and I leave it at that. Thank you.
Thank you, Laura, for that stirring and important intervention. It might seem a bit anticlimactic after such a speech, but I wanted to just put a few historical points into here because we did say we would do an interdisciplinary panel. So let me just say that I think
the 1945 welfare states in Europe embed to a varying degrees a two-tier labor market, one for men, another for women. This is, I'm speaking about the 40s, 50s, and 60s here. And this kind of patriarchal welfare state was based on a male breadwinner norm and a wife who took primary responsibility for the labors of housework and childcare. In this patriarchal welfare state, the male worker was likely to have far better pension rights, particularly since his time in the workforce would not be interrupted by maternity leaves. Now, this was true even for countries like France, which always had an exceptionally high rate of married women's employment and substantial levels of state provision for childcare and education, as well as paid maternity leave since 1913. Now, all of these provisions in France were not granted in the name of gender equality. They were granted in the name of raising the birth rate, and also in the name, very important, of delivering a republican education to the children. And this entailed getting them out of their mother's skirts and into the world as early as possible. But such provision was always also a de facto recognition of working mothers' need for reliable childcare and of employers' need for these women workers. European welfare states were grounded in a system that valorized paid work, especially for men, and obscured the importance of unwaged care work and reproductive labor. Labors of love that were naturalized and so removed from political contestation. Until, of course, second wave feminists began to challenge these presumptions in the late 1960s and 70s, extending understandings of justice and injustice to previously private matters such as sexuality, housework, reproduction, and violence against women, and arguing that these were systemic issues demanding radical transformation of the deep structures of the society. Second wave feminists thus uncovered deep structural connections between women's responsibility for the lion's share of unpaid care work, their subordination in marriage and personal life, the gender segmentation of labor markets, men's domination of the political system, and the male-centeredness of welfare provision and industrial policy. Now, all of this came in the 1970s at a time when the 1945 welfare state system that had embedded male privilege at home and at work was in fact being undermined by neoliberal initiatives intended to replace state dirigisme with privatization and deregulation, replace public provision and social citizenship with trickle-down and personal responsibility, if you can hear the voice of Margaret Thatcher here. Now, there's a paradox here which we need to think about, and which I think came out in a number of the talks we heard today. Some feminist ideals, notably those having to do with cultural claims for the recognition of women's contribution to society, the possibility of female education and greater participation in the labor force, some of this prospered in this new neoliberal environment. But of course, other feminist demands having to do with economic redistributions and questions of social class and inequality were completely marginalized. The result was what one feminist scholar, Hester Eisenstein, calls a dangerous liaison between feminist cultural theory and neoliberalism that I think we saw very strongly in the 1990s. Now, this was all part of a larger resignification of new left countercultural critique in the 60s and 70s of post-war state-organized capitalism, and the absorption of that new left countercultural critique into new neoliberal capitalist forms that emphasize the liberation of individual creativity and the transformation of vertical hierarchies that were characteristic of Fordist industrial organization to horizontal teams and flexible networks. Think Silicon Valley and Google. As the world of good blue-collar jobs, mostly for men, gave way to a world of more flexible, that is, precarious, forms of employment, the central players are less and less the white fathers of families and more young women working at places like Walmart, immigrant workers of both sexes, and the maquiladoras working in dreadful conditions at low-paid industrial labor on the borders. With the new norm being the two-earner family, an elite of women has managed to rise to high visible positions in industry, banking, even academia, which is a bastion of traditionalist resistance, as I'm sure many of you are aware. But for most people, the new norm entails depressed wage levels for both male and female earners, decreased job security, declining living standards, a steep rise in the level of hours worked for wages per household, and a rise in female-headed households. As all of our speakers have shown us, the phenomenon of radically growing social inequality is thus deeply gendered. It's also deeply inflected by race. So we would do well to heed Elena's call to employ intersectional approaches to the intertwined questions of growing class inequality with the paradoxical, seemingly paradoxical, advances of a handful of women and African Americans in the United States, with the neoliberal undoing of traditional welfare states and the replacement of stable with precarious and poorly paid employment. So thus I terminate my historical perspective on today's panel. Thank you. I have some time left for questions, and I'm sure there are many, so please don't hesitate to raise your hands and yes.
There have been quite dramatic changes. I'm thinking particularly of the decline of the coverage of traditional collective bargaining. And I was wondering what impact you thought that would have had on the gender pay gap. I mean, it's been the case in almost across European countries, although much more severely in some than in others.
Thanks very much for that very interesting point. I mean, I think, of course, one has to look at then the structure of collective bargaining in different European states, and there's wide variation there. But there's absolutely no doubt that a very important part of the loan conditions imposed by the Troika, but also the ongoing EU 2020 employment recommendations to the states, very much emphasize the dismantling of collective bargaining structures in the member states. Now, for public sector bargaining, that obviously has a major gender impact in many European states. But overall, I think it's a very important part of the discussion, and clearly feeds into also what Fabrizio said as well about how do we guard against widening class inequalities, because collective bargaining always played a very important function in narrowing the gender pay gap, actually, so across organisations. So this is another very important element we need to factor in. So thank you very much.
I think this is a very relevant question, of course. Something which, when you analyze what has happened to the gender pay gap of the slump, that you see has fallen a lot as well, is bonuses, performance pay related, so variable pay. And since variable pay tends to be highly associated with long hours, et cetera, that's males. That means a fall in male wages. So that could offset, and in some studies, it does offset the fall in wages coming from the public sector where women are overrepresented.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. Question for Fabrizio. You showed us the unintended and unexpected consequences of educational homogamy and so on. So do you have any ideas how to change these consequences? Should one give incentives for heterogamy, or what would you think?
Heterogamy is good. No, joke apart. My point was, and the research that I'm currently undertaking is more on this, the idea how structural forces are shaping patterns in a society. So I think it is one of the underlying mechanisms is increasing inequality underlying. So I think it is impossible to conceive policies that affect matching and the functionings of the marrying labor market. But I think the underlying forces that drives, on one end, the increase in the propensity to marry someone with the same level of education, and also this increased attempt to transmit to your children the advantage you have, is the overall increase in a given that we are currently experiencing in our society. So I think that, and that was also the last message, somehow related also to what Laura was pointing to, that possibly in order to address and to complete the achievement with respect to gender equality, we have to address the broader spectrum of inequality in a given society. So it's an easy answer. I acknowledge that. And okay, then we could discuss whether this is through taxation, different form of distributions, investments in early education for children. So there is a debate. But here was simply to a warning that somehow an increase in gender equality among highly privileged, highly educated women can go hand in hand with an increase in intergenerational inequality and also with an increased inequality among women. So we shouldn't lose sight of that.
Hi, hello, I'm Fulvia Stajano from University College Cork. I have a question for Professor Kilpatrick. You mentioned that as a consequence of the crisis, lots of cuts have been made to healthcare services and to, in general, also childcare services. And we all know that in these cases, this means more burdens for women in the family, and these burdens are also being faced by recurring to domestic work, especially of migrants. But I've been able to observe recently that, especially in Northern European countries and in Ireland and the UK as well, there has been an increasing restrictiveness in legal regimes to admit domestic workers from abroad, especially in Ireland, where domestic work is now among ineligible categories for these schemes, so they cannot enter Ireland. So I was wondering, what is your take on that, and what do you think the effects of these restrictive policies will be? Thank you.
So thanks very much for bringing the migration, restrictive migration regimes into the picture. And actually, I feel coincidentally well placed to answer your question, because one of my supervisees has just submitted her dissertation on migrant domestic workers comparing their legal status across a range of European regimes. So I've just been reading the final version. So in fact, what she shows, this is Veronica Pavlou, you can find her dissertation in the library soon, once I've approved it. So she actually argues that what happens when states become more restrictive is simply you move from a formal entry to an informal entry, so the need for the labour is still there, so the labour still comes, but simply is there on a much more vulnerable basis. So it does have consequences, but it does not stop women coming, especially from outside the EU, in order to do that work. So.
Okay. Hi. I have a question for Laura. So you said that. Faccio in italiano? Okay, benissimo. Allora, okay. Sì, benissimo. Allora, le volevo chiedere, perché lei appunto ha menzionato la questione del congedo parentale come una delle questioni che sono state trattate ultimamente, ma anche in tempi più passati, dal Parlamento europeo. Dato che ovviamente l'uguaglianza delle donne nell'ambito lavorativo dipende molto anche dalla partecipazione dei padri nella sfera privata, quindi nell'accudimento dei figli, mi chiedevo se appunto questa fosse ora in tempi presenti, diciamo, una preoccupazione che il Parlamento europeo ha in mente e se ci sono stati dibattiti su questo punto. Grazie.
My question has to do with parental leave. You mentioned it as being a subject which was addressed by the European Parliament. And obviously the role of women is going to be influenced to a large extent by the participation of fathers in the domestic duties and caring for the child. So my question is, was this a concern for the European Parliament? Was the matter discussed? Was it a subject of debate?
Grazie mille. Prima di risponderti volevo dire alla ragazza che è intervenuta prima che il Parlamento europeo ha appena votato nell'ultima plenaria di Bruxelles 10 giorni fa un documento della collega Cuneva del gruppo della GUE sulle lavoratrici domestiche e la necessità che esista o venga quantomeno incardinata come proposta di direttiva su appunto le lavoratrici domestiche. Questo perché non essendo regolamentata a livello europeo il ruolo delle lavoratrici domestiche, le competenze, le garanzie, le tutele delle quali dovrebbero beneficiare, si apre veramente anche lì un grandissimo vulnus che permette non solo di non far avere le necessarie tutele alle lavoratrici domestiche che vivono la mobilità all'interno dell'Unione Europea non garantite da nessuna normativa, ma anche per chi usufruisce di questo servizio, perché da una parte dovrebbe garantire tutele lavorative con un contratto regolare, dall'altro dovrebbe avere visto che si parla soprattutto di accudimento di anziani e di bambini, professionalità e competenze che siano anche riconosciute attraverso per esempio un riconoscimento dei titoli di studio, cosa che ad oggi l'Unione Europea non garantisce, cioè i titoli di studio all'interno dell'Unione Europea non hanno l'equiparazione. Facciamo tradurre lei e poi rispondo invece a te. Mi sono permessa perché è una cosa sulla quale abbiamo lavorato, è stata più la commissione FEM che non EMPLE, la mia commissione aveva un parere a questo report, la commissione FEM se ne è occupata e la richiesta è stata di una direttiva che possa regolamentare il ruolo delle collaboratrici domestiche.
Thank you. Just before I go on to answer that question, allow me just to make one point about domestic workers, because this is something which was actually voted at the last plenary of Parliament in Brussels. It was a document by our colleague Cuneva from the GUE group on precisely domestic workers and the need for some sort of legal provision or a directive covering them. Why? Well, because they're not well defined, their role is not defined at European level, and therefore the advantages and rights they should be entitled to are not defined either. So here it's not just a question of the protection of these domestic workers, who obviously are subject to a considerable degree of mobility in the European Union without any guarantees. It's also a question of those who receive the services, who should also be receiving the services from the domestic workers in the appropriate legal conditions. And then there's a question of professional qualifications of these people. They are looking after the elderly, doing very specialized tasks very often, and their qualifications are not recognized at European level. I took the liberty of making that point simply because it so happens that in my committee, which is EMPLE, the Committee for Employment, we were asked to provide an opinion to the lead committee, which was FEM, which is the Committee for Women's Affairs, on that very topic, the need for a directive. So now I go on to answer the question which was put to me.
Molto brevemente, il congedo parentale, così come inteso all'interno della direttiva e del report della collega Arena, lo prevede non solo per la madre, ma anche per il padre. Cioè i ruoli all'interno della legislazione europea sono equiparati. Dove posso, e questa è una posizione personale, però dove ravvedo in qualche maniera un limite è nel fatto che ancora oggi ci sia una distinzione dei ruoli che non equipara la maternità alla paternità e dove a fronte della necessità di non trasferire il congedo parentale o quantomeno di trasferirne una quota minima tra un genitore e l'altro, è comunque ripartito in maniera sostanzialmente equa lo stesso diritto sia per il papà che per la madre. Questo è ancora fa parte di una, in qualche maniera, di un limite che ha in particolare la nostra legislazione, ma soprattutto non tanto a livello europeo quanto piuttosto a livello di legislazione italiana nell'ambito del diritto al lavoro, del fatto che si predilige pensare che il ruolo della la genitorialità sia una qualcosa che afferisce soltanto alla madre, quando invece lo stesso congedo può essere goduto negli stessi termini e con le stesse concessioni anche dal padre. Quindi il congedo parentale non ha una discriminazione tra...
Posso?
Sì, sì, in questo hai ragione.
Sì, c'hai ragione. So, it's just a question of... with regard to parental leave now and the need, the directive on that topic and the report produced by our colleague Arena. Parental leave in European legislation envisages both parental leave for the mother and the father. Both are placed on an equal footing in European legislation. My personal opinion, this is my note, my personal note is that looking at the situation in Italy as it now stands, there are in actual fact realities and constraints in that people still do not recognize that maternity and paternity should be on an equal footing here, and there's still just a minimal amount which can be exchanged between mother and father, minimal amount of leave. Italian legislation still tends to favor the mother and therefore consider her as being entitled to maternity leave and doesn't really consider that a man should enjoy the same type of paternity leave.
Scusa, giusto una cosa sul ruolo dei padri. Nel pomeriggio alle 6:30 c'è la sessione Sexual and Reproductive Politics e ci sono molte cose sulle ruole dei padri. Sexual and Reproductive Politics at 4:30 in the teatro this afternoon, where the question of the role of fathers and transformations in fatherhood will be addressed. So.
Volevo fare un'altra domanda a Laura Gea sul congedo maternità. Lei parlava del fatto che è un problema complicato e volevo parlarle del processo per la revisione di questa direttiva sul congedo maternità che è fallito e volevo chiederle, secondo lei, quali sono le cause politiche di questo fallimento e di cosa sarà fatto il futuro in quest'ambito dopo il fallimento della revisione della direttiva.
So the question is still on maternity leave. The revision of the directive failed. Could you perhaps explain the political reasons for that failure and what are future prospects?
Allora, sostanzialmente quello che è stato fatto ad oggi, perlomeno da quando sono arrivata io al Parlamento europeo, ormai sono 2 anni. Ok. Se qualcuno non la... Ok. Quello che è stato fatto un report di iniziativa sul congedo parentale, sulla direttiva. Quindi ancora ad oggi non si è agito direttamente sulla direttiva, ma è stata fatta un report di iniziativa che potrebbe sostanzialmente impegnare la Commissione in un'azione più diretta ad agire sulla direttiva stessa. Oggi ci sono in opera, in cantiere, diversi progetti di revisione di direttive in tema occupazionale. Perché? Perché non ci sono condizioni nel mercato del lavoro, nei 28 Stati membri, che consentono una implementazione omogenea di quelle che sono le direttive. Lo abbiamo visto sui lavoratori distaccati, lo abbiamo visto sulla piattaforma EURES, lo abbiamo visto in tanta regolamentazione europea che non riesce ad essere implementata in maniera efficace dagli Stati membri per una differenza sostanziale di legislazione interna. Le leggi del mercato del lavoro, le leggi così come sono fatte oggi, rendono estremamente complicato implementarle. Oggi cerchiamo di lavorare, è uscita una posizione abbastanza forte e condivisa sul parental leave, ma è un conto è trovare una posizione condivisa in un report di iniziativa, un conto è trovare una posizione condivisa su una direttiva, è ben altra cosa.
What I can say is that since I've arrived in Parliament, what has been done is that an own initiative report was produced on the directive related to parental leave. That own initiative report could lead the Commission to engage in a proper revision of the directive as such. What I can also say is that there are several draft provisions relating to labour law which are being dealt with at the moment, and this is due to the fact that there is a lack of homogeneity in terms of implementation of labour legislation. We've seen this with the directive on detached workers, with the Eures platform and many other issues. There are great differences between domestic labour laws, and this means that it's very hard to implement European legislation. We're trying to do something about this. This own initiative report on parental leave is such a measure, but one thing is to refer to an own initiative report and produce it, and another thing, which is quite different, is produce a new directive.
Thank you very much. I think we have time for one final question before we all pass out from hunger. So,
thank you. It's not simply a question, some consideration. About maternity leave, the last thing I like to remember is that we had a resolution by the European Parliament about maternity leave in October 2010. And this that was put aside and no more followed because of opposition from some government in Europe. So not a problem of European institution, but position of Business Europe, that is Confindustrium for Italians, and governments, especially for northern area in Europe. And so the proceeding has begun again, but we don't know where it will arrive. The other thing is that, okay, we have flexibility, to face with the transformation in labor market by one point of view. By the other point of view, we have mostly precarious work that goes on. And economic crisis created especially precarious work. Maternity leaves is a protection for employees. Women in precarious work have no protection for maternity leaves, problem of a career, problem of pension gap, because they have not a work career that allows to think the pension at all. So maybe we have to think about politics, not only to change the labor market, which is going on about a progressive destruction, in my opinion, and in fact we have a lot of financement for self-entrepreneurship as a thing correspondent to the changing or diminution employer market. But maybe the way to think only to growth of this model of economy must be rethought, because it is creating inequality and not simply an evolution in progress. Thank you.
Personally, I'm in agreement with you about this, and I think that these are difficult problems, and that there is there's a way in which bits of feminist
ideas about equality, gender equality, that were conceptualized in the very different context of the 1960s and 1970s have been absorbed into the precarious labor market created through neoliberal policies and presented as a kind of liberation, freedom, greater gender equality, when in fact it's part of a growing social class inequality. And I think, again, the answer is the kind of intersectional analysis that Elena proposed. So thank you very much for your comments, and thank you all of you for your discussion, attending our panel, and I hope you enjoy the day. Thank you.